بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وكنتينيو وي ليفت اوف ان ذا بوك ثلاث الاصول، والشيخ محمد ابن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله عليه. And just before continuing, I wanted to highlight a few things. From the things that I wanted to highlight, first of all, is the khilaf with regard to the title of the book. I think we've mentioned it already, and I've said that you can say it both ways. And this is جريان على ما هو حاصل. This is just following what commonly occurs in the prints of the books and whatnot. But in terms of diqqa and precision, then a number of the people acknowledge Sheikh Salih Al Sheikh, also Sheikh Al Usaymi. They pointed to the fact that there's a difference between ثلاثة الأصول and الأصول الثلاثة. So from the point where the author he mentioned إعلم رحمك الله, that part of the book is referred to as al-usul al-thalatha. Take it as a benefit. And it was a mukhtasar, it's been abbreviated from the actual thalathat al-usul, for they have said some of the people knowledge have said that he abbreviated it in order to teach the awam, to teach the general masses of the Muslims. So he abbreviated this thalathat al-usul, which we are now in order to teach and propagate the correct tawheed in a simplified manner to them. So the first book is called the Al-Usul Al-Thalatha, and as for this, the more detailed book, then this is referred to as Thalathat Al-Usul. So when you're doing the tasmi', you stick to that, which is قال الشيخ الإمام المجدد محمد بن عبد الوهاب في ثلاثة الأصول, and then go into what he mentioned. And like I said, as for the Usul Al-Thalatha, it's the previous risala that we took. As for what we took also in yesterday's gathering, the author's statement, وَأَنَا وَاحِدٌ مِّن ذَلِكَ الْعَالَمِ, that I am one of this alam. So this here, the proof being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is our Lord, is the statement of Allah, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So the Shaykh, how does he deal with this, or how does he tend to it? He says, the alameen, yani alam is anything besides Allah, is referred to as an alam. And I am one of that alam. So Shaykh Al-Usaymi, he has a ta'liq on this mas'ala, that this istilah to refer to everything besides Allah as an alam, this is something that the muta'akhirun have brought about. لا يوجد في كلام العرب إطلاق عالم على مجموع ما سوى الله, because you don't find in the speech of the Arabs that everything collectively besides Allah is referred to as alam. Rather, this is from the speech of the ulama of kalam. That's what he says. جَرَ بِهِ لِسَانُ عُلَمَاءِ الْكَلَامِ. Then it entered into the متَكَلِّمِينَ فِي الْعُلُومِ. And then they have placed these muqaddimat, these premises for what they are intending by this. You have الخالق القديم والعالم حادث. The creator, he was there from the very beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator has no limit. And he was there in the infinite past. To be more precise in using the correct terminology, he was there from the infinite past. And as for the alam, then that which is created, then it is hadith. It occurred after not being in existence. طيب, so he points to Ibn Ashur mentioning this in the Tahrir al-Tanwir, and that we do not interpret the Quran based on these mustalahat, based on the terminologies that the people have come about with afterwards. So now the question is, he's saying that we cannot refer to everything besides Allah as alam. كل ما سوى الله فهو عالم. Everything besides Allah is alam. We can't refer to everything besides Allah as alam. But the alam, it is basically a species. What you would translate in English is a species. A number of things that have a similarity between them. The sulala is more like offspring would be sulala, but something it's a number of creation that collectively they have a resemblance and an origin that they share. This would be referred to as an alam. So you have alam al tuyur, the world of the birds, alam al samak, alam al kilab, alam kada, alam kada. So majmu' collectively, when there is a species of a particular animal or a particular thing, then you refer to it as a alam, alam of this, alam of that, alam of that. So would this not then lead to us coming back and saying that if everything it does have species in essence, then for you to say everything besides Allah isn't alam, it will not be criticized. Would still enter from one angle, يعني, ولكن look at this ta'qib. The ta'qib is daqiq, it's very precise in what he's saying. He's saying إِنَّ جَمْعَ هَذِي الْأَفْرَادِ الْمُتَجَانِسَ. So we would refer to it in Arabic if you're trying to say species. هو the alam is ism لجمع أفراد متجانسة. واسم the word alam is a title or a name لأفراد متجانسة for any species of things which are similar. He said, would you not say then this would return back to that which has been said? فإذا كان عالم الجن عالما على أفراد متجانسة. يعني if the world of the jinn is a title for those that resemble each other from them. وعالم الإنس عالم, and also the عالم of the humans is similar, and the عالم of the angels likewise. فإن إذن يكون المجموع العالمون. Then all of this together would become عالمون. And based on that, we would say that there's no complication in what the Shaykh has said. Everything besides Allah is عالم. He says, يقال, it's responded by saying, ليس كل خلق الله مندرجا في الأفراد المتجانسة. Not every one of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter into what we may refer to as being a species of something. What's an example? He says, like the Arsh, like the Jannah, like the Kursi, like the Nar. We don't refer to them as being an alam. So there's a number of thrones of Allah. There's a number of paradises, for example. Yani you're not going to give this the title of al-alam. So what would be the correct title then for these afrad al-mutajanisa, these species of things which these individual species that resemble each other? يعني what would be a better istidlal then to use instead of the statement of the author here, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen? What would be a more appropriate or suitable evidence? He mentions that we can do this. إِنَّمَا يُسْتَدَلْ عَلَى عُمُومُ رُبَبِيَةِ اللَّهِ لِلْخَلْقِ جَمِيعًا بِقَوْلِهِ. What can be used, really what can be used as an evidence to affirm the rububiyya of Allah over all of the creation is the statement of Allah, هُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وهو رب كل شيء, that Allah is the Lord of everything. فإنه يعم كل شيء, because this would enter, this would it would generally apply to everything. So a more clear evidence would be, instead of coming to this, الحمد لله رب العالمين, a more clear evidence would be وهو رب كل شيء, and that Allah is the Lord of everything. So here we have no problem, because he can say here. But the author, if he was to use that, he'd say, وَأَنَا شَيْءٌ مِنْ تِلْكَ الْأَشْيَاءِ, and I am a thing from the things that Allah created. Jade. So the criticism is just from one angle. There are things that you do not use the word alam to apply to. There are things that you do not use the word alam to apply to, such as the throne of Allah, such as the kursi of Allah. And being that there are things that you do not refer to using the word alam, you want to use a title that indicates Allah is the Lord of everything. You want to use an evidence that indicates that Allah is the Lord of everything, such as what we've taken here. وَهُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. You got that? So this is just a benefit which I wanted to share with regard to this. You may come across it as well in the other shuruhat. I just thought to mention this. So the asal of it is istilah kalami. It's from the jargon of the scholars of kalam. And then it was inherited by some of the scholars who began to then apply it in their works. And the whole basis of this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala huwa qadim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was there from the infinite past. Wal alam hadith. And the word alam is used for everything which is created. So here they put this together and concluded that everything besides Allah is alam. This is where the istidlal or the usage of the evidence came from. They will come back to where we left off. So we had stopped by the statement of the author here. One min makhluqatihi, and from the creation of Allah, al-azima. So this is under what segment? Just so we're on the same page. What is he clarifying here by saying one min makhluqatihi, and from his creation? What is he discussing? الأصل الأول، more specifically within the أصل الأول. بارك الله فيك. How would you come to know of your Rabb? How would you come to know of Allah that you worship? So he's mentioned that he would come to know of him by his signs. And now he's going into the signs of Allah Azza wa Jal. And listen to them. ومن مخلوقاته. And from the creation of Allah, العظيمة, the great creation of Allah, السماوات السبع, the seven heavens. وسعتها وارتفاعها. And its spaciousness and elevation. والأرضون السبع. And the seven earths. وامتدادها. And how vast they are. وسعة أرجائها, and the great length of its broadness, والتقدير أقواتها, and the قوات, which is a plural of قوت, the provisions which have been decreed in them. وما فيهن, so you have these seven heavens, and what is in them, أي ما في السماوات السبع من الكواكب الزاهرات, that which is in these seven heavens, from these كواكب, these stars which are glowing, which are illuminating. والآيات الباهرات, and these marvelous signs. وما في الأرضين السبع, and that which is in these seven earths. من الجبال والبحار, from the mountains as well as the seas. وأصناف المخلوقات, and likewise these different creations, أصناف المخلوقات, these different forms and types of creations, من الحيوانات والنباتات وسائر الموجودات, from the animals, from the plants, and from all of these different موجودات, plural of موجود, which is that which is present. So from the evidences that indicate, first of all, do we have from the Quran that which indicates that there are seven earths? Anyone draw for us any evidence that indicates that the earth is seven earths from the Quran? As for the Sunnah, نعم. The hadith, من أخذ قيد شبر ظلما طوقه يوم القيامة من سبع أراضين. Whoever takes the hand span's length of earth, he takes this in oppression. So your fence was to here, and you took a handspan's length only in oppression, then you're going to be strangled with the seven earths beneath it on the Day of Judgment. طويقه من سبع أراضٍ.
About someone
worshiping
the
سبع سماوات, جيد. We want the earth, so سبع سماوات comes. They mention actually in the Quran سبع السماوات, with the word سبع, seven heavens. It comes in the Quran seven times. We want the seven earths. Anyone know of any دليل from the Quran? نعم بارك الله فيك. الله عز وجل حسن. الله الذي خلق سبع سماوات ومن الأرض مثلهن. This is towards the end of the طلاق. Allah, he created the seven heavens, ومن الأرض, and from the earth, مثلهن, the likes of it. So Ibn Jawzi says, بعددهن, يعني the likes of this number of, the likes of this number of earths, the seven heavens, and the likes thereof of earths, you may say. So this is from the clearest of evidences in the Quran. Besides this ayah, in fact, in the Quran, there's no other mention of seven earths. Seven earths. And the people of knowledge have differed with regards to how these seven earths, how we're to understand them. And the closest of these views is that these are these ardun, these earths, that they are atbaq, as Allah, he referred to the heavens as sab'a samawat, and he created them tibaqa, one on top of the other. So you have the first heaven, then you have the second heaven, then you have the third heaven, and there's a difference between the heaven and paradise. People confuse the two. Do not confuse the heaven with the paradise. There is samawat, and then you have the jannah. As Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions, "Indaha jannatul ma'wa." And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he elevated in Laylat al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. In the Mi'raj, he continued to elevate until he went beyond the seven heavens. And then you had Sidratul Muntaha, the final law tree, and the Prophet ascended, and he was given the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that point. So you have the seven heavens and above the heavens, عندها جنة المأوى. There you have the Jannah. There you have the Jannah. So you have these seven heavens which are atbaq. Some narrations indicate that between one heaven and the heaven above it is a distance of 500 years. Another narration indicates 700 years. Then you have the following heaven likewise. So they're atbaq, one after the other. And also this is indicated in the hadith of Anas fil Mi'raj, when the Prophet was ascending and he was with Jibreel. Each time he would come to a heaven, he would seek permission and they would say, Man Jibreel wa man ma'aka Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then they would open for him and then he would continue to ascend. So it shows that they're guarded, they were protected and preserved, and they're on top of each other. So likewise, the earth, they're like that. The earths which are beneath us, they are like that as well. These Saba Arabun. This is the best of opinions that the people of knowledge have mentioned with regard to this. Also, the hadith of Umm Salama indicates this, that a person, if he was to take land, handspan's length of earth unjustly, then all of the earth, the seven earths beneath it, he's going to be punished with it on the day of judgment. Wallahu musta'an. Right. Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he quotes here the God to the statement of Allah, Allah الذي خلق سبع سماوات من الأرض مثلهن. Allah created the seven heavens and from the earth the likes thereof. قال عم فقال في كل أرض مثل إبراهيم ونحو ما على الأرض. So there's some statements that there are actual seven different planets. They have different views. So some of them have listed, if I remember correctly, there's about seven or eight different views with regard to this matter. A lot of these statements, they have no evidence for. That's why the safest of views and the clearest of views in this matter and interpreting this ayah is a statement of the people of knowledge who have mentioned that they're atbaq, that they're one earth after the other, beneath each other in levels, just like the heavens above us are levels. طيب. So we'll continue back where we left off in the book. The author, he says, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا. So the, how we have recognized Allah is through His great creations, the seven heavens. Then you have the seven earths, and that which is in these seven heavens and seven earths, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا, and that which is between them. أي مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْهَوَاءِ وَغَيْرِهِ. That which is between the seven, the heavens and the earth, from hawa, from the air, and other than this. وَمَا بَدَى لَهُمْ مِنْ سَيْرِهِمْ مِنْ مَوْطٍ إِلَى مَوْطٍ فِي جَوِّ السَّمَاءِ. And that which appears to them. وَمَا بَدَى لَهُمْ مِنْ سَيْرِهِمْ, and that which they can see, which is evident to them from their traveling, from one place to another, فِي جَوِّ السَّمَاءِ, in the sky. وَمَا ظَهَرَ لَهُمْ مِنْ مَنَافِعٍ, and that which also presents itself to them from benefits. من نقل ما يتحدثون به وهم في بلد. يعني the transmission of that which they are saying while they're in another land. وغيرهم في بلد آخر. I think he's referring here to this modern technology, the planes which are traveling. So the phones, you're in one land and in another land. All of these things, they're from that which Allah Azza wa Jal, He has decreed. وغير ذلك وغيرهم في بلد آخر. فسبحان الله رب العرش العظيم. To glory be to Allah, the Lord of the Mighty Throne. فحري بكل مسلم التفكر في آيات الله ومخلوقاته. So it is deserved. حري, you may say حري, you may say جدير. They are similar meaning. It's befitting. بكل مسلم. For every Muslim, التفكر, to reflect في آيات الله, over the signs of Allah ومخلوقاته and his creation. قال ابن جزي المالكي, ابن جزي said رحمه الله, التفكر هو ينبوع كل حال ومقام. That to reflect, to think, it is a spring. ينبوع is a spring. It is a spring, a spring of every circumstance and state the person is in. فمن تفكر في عظمة الله اكتسب التعظيم. So whoever reflects over the greatness of Allah, he earns for himself greatness. وَمَنْ تَفَكَّرَ فِي قُدْرَتِهِ اسْتَفَادَ التَّوَكُّلِ. And whoever thinks about the ability of Allah عز وجل, he will benefit التوكل, reliance on Allah. ومن تفكر في عذابه استفاد الخوف. And whoever thinks about the punishment of Allah, he will benefit يعني fear in him. ومن تفكر في رحمته استفاد الرجاء. And whoever thinks about the mercy of Allah, then he will benefit hope. ومن تفكر في الموت وما بعده استفاد قصر الأمل. And whoever thinks about death and that which will follow it, then he will benefit for himself shortening or limiting his hopes. To limit your hopes, not thinking 20, 30 years down the line, ولكن day to day. ومن تفكر في ذنوبه اشتد خوفه. And whoever thinks about his sins, then his fear will increase. وصغرت عنده نفسه. وصغرت عنده نفسه. And his soul will lessen the value of his soul, maybe the ego that he may have lessen inshallah by way of this. So it's a benefit to the state that you're in and thinking about the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal, it will always lead you to a benefit for yourself, whether it's a greatness, whether it's his ability, whether it is his punishment. Then just thinking about this should render you in a more positive state of mind. And all of this is a benefit, because if you don't do this, then you will just be continuing your seer upon destruction. And you will find that naturally when the person is disobedient to Allah Azza wa Jal, ليس لهم تفكر في هذه الأشياء. There's not a time that they want to think about this. ولا حتى نفسه تطمئن. His soul will not even find tranquility. They always want to put this behind themselves or put it in the back burner. Whenever the thought of Allah comes, they want to put it behind themselves, because they don't want the burden of what it will lead to, even though it's beneficial for them. لو كانوا يعلمون. ودليل قوله تعالى, and the proof for this is a statement of Allah تعالى. And the proof for the proof for the ayat الكونية, the proof for Allah عز وجل creating His creations. ومن آياته الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر. And from the signs of Allah is the night and the day, the sun and the moon. لا تسجد للشمس ولا للقمر. Do not perform sujood for the sun or the moon. واسجدوا لله. But perform sujood for Allah الذي خلقهن إن كنتم إياه تعبدون. The one who created them, if it is Him that you truly worship. وقوله تعالى, in the statement of Allah the Most High, إن ربكم الله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض في ستة أيام ثم استوى على العرش. Indeed, your Lord is Allah, the one who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, ثم استوى على العرش. Then he ascended over his throne. والدليل, and the proof, على أن الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر من آيات الله. That the heavens, that the, rather the night and the day, the sun and the moon, these are from the signs of Allah Azza wa Jalla. The proof for this, that's what he was pointing to, the dalil. يعني the dalil that the ayat al-kawniya, they're from the makhlukat of Allah. The dalil that the signs that we see within the existence, they have been created by Allah. قوله تعالى is the statement of Allah the Most High, ومن آياته, and from his signs, الدالة على كمال قدرته, which indicate the complete, the perfect ability of Allah ووحدانيته, and that he is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. ونفوذ مشيئته, and the passing of his decree or what he willed. يعني passing meaning that it occurs. نفوذ الشيء هو وقوعه. It's something that passes and happens. وسعة سلطانه, and his vast authority. ورحمته بعباده, and his mercy for his servants. الليل, the night. بمنفعة ظلمته, يعني بمنفعة, بمنفعة ظلمته, يعني in the benefit of its darkness. وسكون الخلق فيه, and the stillness of the creation in it. والنهار, and the daylight, بمنفعة ضيائه, by way of the benefit of its light. وتصرف العباد فيه, and that the servants will dispose of their affairs in it, and they attend to their needs, in other words. والشمس والقمر, and the sun and the moon, اللذان لا تستقيم معايش العباد إلا بهما. These two matters, that the livelihoods of the creation will not be established except by way of them. لا تسجدوا للشمس ولا للقمر. Do not perform sujood for the sun or the moon. فإنهما, مدبران مسخران مخلوقان because they are مدبر they have been organized or they have been structured مسخر put to service and created لا يستحقان أن يسجد لهما they do not deserve for any sujood to be done for them واسجدوا لله and perform sujood for Allah لا لغيره ووحدوه فهو and single him out for indeed he is الذي خلقهن the one who created them فإنهما for indeed the sun and the moon the dhamir the two of them is going back to the sun and the moon وإن كبر حجمهما even though their size may be great فإن ذلك ليس منهما then this is not from them and it's not the sun and the moon that have given themselves that size وإنما هو من خالقها rather it is by the one who created them إن كنتم إياه تعبدون if it is him that you worship وحده جل وعلا alone mighty and majestic he is تعبدون the one that you worship فخصوه بالعبادة وإخلاص الدين so specify him in worship and make your religion solely for him so what he's doing here is a method of sharh where they're merging instead of leaving the ayah and then commenting on the ayah he's merging his speech within the ayah this is a method of some of the shuruhat whether it's in the books of fiqh or lugha or qida mustalah they take this method at times where they merge their speech within the speech of whether it's the Quran or whether it's a hadith or whether it's the speech of the author so he's merging it here so staying with the flow of how the speech is going in accordance with the ayat is important إن كنتم إياه if it is him وحده alone جل وعلا if it is him alone جل وعلا تعبدون that you worship يعني فخصوه بالعبادة وإخلاص الدين so single him out specify him with worship and single him out and be sincere to him in your religion والدليل and now comes the statement and the statement of the author الدليل على أن السماوات السبع والأراضين السبع من مخلوقات الله الدالة عليه the proof that the seven heavens and the seven earths are from the creation of Allah which point to him جل وعلا قوله تعالى is the statement of Allah the most high إن ربكم الله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض indeed your Lord is Allah who created the heavens and the earth وما فيهما and that which is between the heavens and the earth والذي أتقن خلقهما and the one who perfected their creation وأحكم بنيانهما and also constructed well or أحكم is similar to أتقن to perfect to complete well their construction في ستة أيام in 6 days أولهما يوم الأحد وآخرها يوم الجمعة the first of these days was the Ahad which is a Sunday and the last of these days was the Jumu'ah which is what we refer to as a Friday now this is mentioned by some of the scholars of Tafsir and their likes in this relation I have not come across any authentic text that indicates this exact structure that this day was this and this day was that and this day was that but we're given numbers ثم لما قضاها وأودع فيها من أمره ما أودع then when Allah completed he perfected them Allah يعني لما أتمها when Allah perfected them and he placed in them from his commandment what he placed استوى he ascended جل وعلا على العرش of the throne العظيم the great throne الذي وسع السماوات والأرض which has encompassed the greatness of this throne has encompassed it's broader than you may even say the heavens and the earth وما فيهما and that which is in the two of them وما بينهما and that which is between them استواء أن يليق بجلاله وعظمته He ascended in a manner that befits His majesty and glory جل وعلا So you benefit from this يعني that if the كرسي وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض The كرسي alone where they say is the author of Ibn Abbas indicating what is the كرسي على الراجح من أقوال أهل العلم the statements of the people of knowledge Ibn Abbas's interpretation of the كرسي is being taken نعم موضع القدمين it's the place the 2 feet of Allah جل وعلا and Allah he says about the كرسي وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض the كرسي has encompassed the heavens and the earth so all of this is small and insignificant in relation to the size of the kursi. And the arsh is above that, the throne of Allah. And so they say the greatest of the creation of Allah Jalla wa'ala, أَعْظَمُ مَخْلُوقَاتِهِ الْعَرْشِ. The greatest of Allah's creation is the throne of Allah Jalla wa'ala. So you can imagine how great, if you have these seven heavens, hundreds of years journey between each other, and all of those seven heavens and the seven earths which are like it, the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encompassed it. فَمَا بَالُ الْعَرْشِ. What should we perceive about the greatness of the arsh of Allah Jalla wa'ala? وَاللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And Allah is greater than everything. This should just increase in your humility that we are puny, very small upon the earth. And you take from this a tawadu. When you have this, you tafakkur fi azamati Allah, yurithuka tawadu. When you think about the greatness of Allah, this should increase you in humility. That's why Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. Do not walk upon the earth arrogantly. إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَفِقَ الْأَرْضِ. You're not able to pierce the earth. وَلَنْ تَبْلُغَ الْجِبَالَ طُولًا. Nor are you able to reach the mountains in height. When the person walks, no matter how they walk, you're not able to pierce the earth. And nor are you the size of the mountains. And the mountains themselves, they're nothing in terms of the greatness of these samawat and the ard. The mountains become puny things, these things that we're seeing. That a human, it will take the knowledge of these mountains on the earth, they will say, for example, Mount Everest, it will take you months to get to the peak of that. Months as a human. And it is nothing in terms of the greatness of the rest of the creation of Allah Jalla wa'ala. It is a small thing. So that's what the author is telling us, this tafakkur, thinking about the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, this leads to benefits for the person who thinks of Allah. So he goes on to continue the ayah, يُغْشِي اللَّيْلَ النَّهَارَ يَطْلُبُهُ حَثِيثًا. He makes the night cover the day, يَطْلُبُهُ حَثِيثًا. It seeks it quickly. And so the succession between the night and the day is quick. والشمس والقمر والنجوم مسخرات بأمره. The sun and the moon and the stars, they have been put to service through his command. ألا له الخلق والأمر. To him belongs the creation and the command. تبارك الله رب العالمين. Blessed is he, جل وعلا, the Lord of all of the worlds. And just to quickly digress for benefit here, ألا له الخلق والأمر. The people of knowledge mentioned that this is from the evidences that the speech of Allah Jalla wa'ala is not created. That the speech of Allah is not created. Because Allah said to him belongs al-khalq, the creation, wal-amr, and the commandment. If the speech of Allah was created, then it would be in general from the generality of the khalq. It would enter under the creation. Walakin when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made a distinction between the khalq wal-amr, this indicates that the speech of Allah Jalla wa'ala is not created. This is from the evidences that the people of knowledge from the Salaf, and those who follow them use. وَهُوَ سُبْحَانَهُ. And he سُبْحَانَهُ يُغْشِي اللَّيْلَ أي يَجْعَلُ اللَّيْلَ الْمُظْلِمْ يُغَطِي النَّهَارِ. He makes the night which is dark cover the day. المضي, which is plain and clear and illuminating. فَيَعُمُّ الظَّلَامِ وَجْهَ الْأَرْضِ وَيَبْقَى كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فِي الظَّلَامِ. So the darkness, it covers the face of the earth, وَيَبْقَى كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فِي الظَّلَامِ. And all of those who are upon the earth, they remain in darkness. وَيَسْكُنُ الْآدَمِيُونَ. And the children of Adam become still at that point. وَتَأْوِي الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ إِلَى مَسَاكِنِهَا. And the creation return back to their dwellings. يَطْلُبُهُ حَثِيثًا. It seeks it quickly, أي سَرِيعًا. كُلَّمَا جَاءَ اللَّيْلِ ذَهَبَ النَّهَارِ. Every time the night advances, the day goes. وَكُلَّمَا جَاءَ النَّهَارِ ذَهَبَ اللَّيْلِ. And every time the daylight comes, the night goes. طَلَبًا لَا فُتُورَ فِيهِ وَلَا التَّأْخِيرَ. And it's this, there's a seeking which is occurring between the night and the day, that there is no futur, there is no rest or weariness in it, or تَأْخِيرَ or delay. حَتَّى يَطْوِي اللَّهُ هَذَا الْعَالَمِ وَإِنْتَقِلُ الْعِبَادِ لَدَانَ الْقَرَارِ. Until Allah Azza wa Jal, He folds this creation, and the servants, they then make transition to the abode which is everlasting, Dar al-Qarar. الشمس والقمر والنجوم. والشمس والقمر والنجوم. The sun, the moon, and the stars. الثابتة والسائرة. And he comments here upon the stars saying those stars which ثابتة, they do not move, والسائرة, and those that make transition. As the stars, there are two groups of stars. The stars that will remain in their position in the sky, and there are stars that travel or not. And if you're to look at, here due to light pollution is not really possible, but if you're abroad or you're in the countryside, if you're awake at the night, in the time of the night, and you're able to see the stars, you will see as if the stars are almost traveling in the sky. They also have their manazil, the places that they sit. And some of them, they just remain still. So these moon, these the sun, the moon, these creations, the sun, the moon, and the stars, he refers to as الثابتة والسائرة, these stars that some do not move, and those that do move, مُسَقَّرَاتٍ بِأَمْرِهِ, they have been put to service through his command, وَتَدْبِيرِهِ, and his organization of them, وَعِلْمِهِ وَحِكْمَتِهِ, and his knowledge and wisdom. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ, verily to him belongs the creation, بَلَا إِنَّ لَهُ الْخَلْقَ الَّذِي صَدَرَتْ عَنْهُ جَمِيعُ الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ. وهذا, in fact, it is to him that the creation belongs to, this, the creation, the act of creating, he's able to create, which صدرت عنه, they occurred from it, all of the different creation. ويتضمن أحكامه الكونية القدرية. And they consist of the rulings of Allah عز وجل which are within the existence. ويتضمن أحكامه الكونية القدرية. So the rulings of Allah عز وجل, the أحكام الكونية القدرية, are the rulings of Allah جل وعلا, what Allah He has decreed within the creation that occurs. These are أحكام كونية قدرية. و and ألا له, and verily to him belong الأمر, the command. بلا إن له الأمر المتضمن للشرائع والنبوات. نعم, to him belongs the command in which the command which consists of the legislations of Allah and nubuwat and the prophethoods. وهذا يتضمن جميع أحكامه الدينية الشرعية. And this consists of all of the rulings of Allah جل وعلا and the legislation and his religion. So, يعني you have الأمر الكوني and الأمر الشرعي. This is what he's pointing to. طيب, الأمر الكوني والشرعي. So the أمر الشرعي is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has loved and He has ordered with within the legislation. And the kawni is that which transpires, whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves it or He does not love it, whether it is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He's pleased with or He's not pleased with. The things that occur within the existence, they return back to the kawn. Allah, He does them for wisdom. He does them for wisdom. This is the view of Ahlul Sunnah with regard to the qadr of Allah Jalla wa'ala. تبارك الله, blessed is He, the Most High, بلغ في البركة النهاية. إذا الله سبحانه وتعالى, He is full of blessing. The utmost extent of blessing He has. وهي صيغة لا تصلح إلا لله. And it is a phrase that is not befitting except for Allah. So the word تبارك, you should not use it except in relation to Allah. فهو سبحانه عظم وتعالى وكثر خيره. For He glorified is He. Great He was. And lofty He was. And كثر خيره. The goodness that comes from Him is plentiful. تبارك في اسمه لعظمة أوصافه. Blessed is His name due to the greatness of His attributes وكمالها and the perfection of these attributes. How perfect they are. وبارك في غيره. And it is He who blesses others. بإحلال الخير الجزيل والبر الكثير. By placing within them much goodness. الخير الكثير والبر الجزيل. And a kindness which is plentiful. As we mentioned, the definition of the baraka being ثبوت الخير الإلهي في شيء. It is goodness from Allah which is being established in something. وهو سبحانه رب العالمين. And He glorified is He is the Lord of the worlds. المنعم عليهما. المنعم عليهم بخيراته والسابق فضله. The one who blesses the creation with the khayrat, the goodness that he has, وَالسَّابِغْ فَضْلِهِ, and his vast grant. سَابِغْ is basically something that covers. He covers us with what he gives us from his provisions, blessings, and so on. Now he's going to come to another mas'ala, clarifying further what is intended by the Rabb. هو الرب. So he says والرب هو المعبود والدليل قوله تعالى that the word رب, the title or the name of Allah, الرب, he is المعبود, the one that's worshipped. And the proof of this is a statement of Allah, يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم. All mankind, worship your Lord who created you. والذين من قبلكم and those who came before you لعلكم تتقون. So that you may be from the pious. الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا. The one who made for you the earth as a mat. والسماء بناء. And the heavens as a construction. وأنزل من السماء ماء. And he sent down from the heavens water. فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم. And he removed by way of this water provisions, produce as a provision for you. فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا. So do not make for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala equals وأنتم تعلمون while you know. So after mentioning that Allah is our Lord, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, then mentioning the signs that we are able by way of them to recognize Allah, he mentioned some of the greatest of these signs, these celestial bodies, the sun and the moon, the sun, the moon, the stars, and he mentioned the night and the day. So after mentioning these signs that we're able to recognize our Creator, he then comes back to tell us that our Creator, Allah, Ar-Rabb, he's the one who deserves to be worshipped. So he says, وَالْرَبُّ أَلْخَالِقُ لِتِلْكَ الْمَخْلُوقَاتِ الْعَظِيمَةِ Rabb, the Lord, he is the one who has created these great creations. مِنَ السَّمَاوَاتِ السَّبْعِ وَمَا فِيهِنَّ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا From the seven heavens, and that which is within them and between them. هو المالك المتصرف المتصف بصفات الكمال. He is the owner, the one who disposes in them as he pleases, and has these perfect attributes. وهو المعبود, and he is the one that's worshipped. المستحق للعبادة وحده. The one who deserves to be worshipped alone, دون من سواه. Excluding anyone else. وما سواه مخلوق مربوب ضعيف. And anything besides Allah is a creation that is under Allah's subjugation and is weak. لا يملك لنفسه نفعا ولا ضرا. And does not possess any ability to benefit or harm itself. Even if a person wanted to bring benefit or harm. كل هذا بقدر الله. وعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك. The Prophet told Ibn Abbas, if the entire nation was together to benefit you with something, they would not be able to benefit you except with what Allah has already written. And likewise, if they wanted to harm you, they would only be able to harm you with what Allah has decreed. So the creation is ضعيف. لا يملك النفع والضر. It doesn't own harm and benefit independently. It's only what Allah has decreed for them to be able to do. والدليل, and then the proof, he says, على أن الرب هو المعبود. So he said, that the Rabb, Allah, he is the one who is worshipped. So what's the delil? He brings his proof here. قوله تعالى is the statement of Allah, يا أيها الناس أو mankind, من ذكر وأنثى, from males and females. The word الناس, here as you can see, it seems that it's only restricted to mankind. ولكن the correct view among the people of knowledge is that you can use the word ناس even for the jinn. You can use the word ناس for the jinn. Due to the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud fi al-Bukhari. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَنَّ النَّاسًا مِنَ الْإِنْسِ كَانُوا يَعْبُدُونَ نَاسًا مِنَ الْجِنِ That there were people from the ins who used to worship a people from the jinn. فَأَسْلَمَ أُولَئِكَ And those jinn became Muslim, فَبَقِيَ هَؤُلَاءِ عَلَى عِبَادَتِهِمْ And the ins remained worshipping them. The ins remained worshipping them. أولئك الذين يدعون يبتغون إلى ربهم الوسيلة أيهم أقرب. Under the statement of Allah, those that you call upon, they seek closeness to Allah themselves. Those that you call upon, they seek closeness to Allah themselves. So there's a difference of opinion with regard to who's being intended here. Some have said these are the righteous, the likes of Isa, the likes of Uzair, the likes of the Malaika. They're being worshipped besides Allah, and they themselves are seeking closeness to Allah. That's one view. Another view is in this hadith of Ibn Mas'ud that there were people who used to worship some jinn. Those jinn then became Muslim. And those people remained worshipping them. So from there they have taken the itlaq that you can use the word nas even for the jinn at time, in the sense that they're a people, not in the sense that it's a species, because the word nas is at times used for a people, not a species. So here, ya ayuha nas, O mankind, the amr with ibadah, the amr to worship Allah, is it specific to humans? La. فلا بد أن نعمم. It is a must that we generalize. وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون. I have not created jinn and mankind except for my worship. So here it's more appropriate to say ناس يعني ذكر أو أنثى أو جن أو إنس. That's the point here. أعبدوا worship إيه وحدوا single out ربكم your Lord فهو المنعم عليكم بنعم الظاهرة والباطنة. Single out your Lord for indeed He is the one who blesses you with blessings which are evident and apparent as well as باطنة. They're concealed. وهو الذي خلقكم and it is he who has created you وأوجدكم من العدم and brought you into existence from inexistence والذين من قبلكم and those who came before you كذلك likewise خلقهم الله بعد أن لم يكونوا شيئا it is Allah who created them from nothing Allah created them after a time that they were nothing وذكرهم الله بهذه النعمة العظيمة and Allah he reminded them of this great blessing This great blessing that He created you from nothing, why you being reminded and provided for you, لعلكم تتقون, so that you may be from the pious. طيب, we'll stop here. I'll continue from this point in the coming halaqah.